happening on Sunday. As I was carrying in the music and the bulletins tonight, I was carrying both the Easter and the Good Friday. And it was so great that I could look at both. And I think about the people who had no idea that Easter was coming and how sad they might have been. But at the same time, I'm just thankful that we know that Jesus has risen, and that should impact us as well. We're going to be singing a few songs this evening, and we're going to ask that you join in as you're able to. If you don't know the songs, just meditate on the words and ask the Lord to speak to you through all of that. And thankful for Rachel and Elise that are singing with us tonight and can participate with us musically in Good Friday. We prayed for Sarah earlier, and we pray that the message that the Lord has given her would find its mark in all of our hearts, and that we'd have a very special evening together looking at the sacrifice of Jesus.
Don't you see a dollar? you that, you know, you even know what was ahead of you when you came to earth. You knew the end of your earthly life, and that's something to look forward to, you know, something, you know, really sad, but we thank you that you hung in there, Lord. Thank you for doing what you had to do to have us with you. We really appreciate that. We appreciate your sacrifice and actually doing the job that you had to do. So thank you for your willingness to do that for us, and we worship you even more in Jesus' name.
Thank you. pray about what I felt like we were to kind of symbolize and share, I felt like it was important to mention our brothers and sisters in Ukraine. And so we have a few things to kind of honor them, some things that are traditional for them. We have dyed eggs, in the red dyed eggs in the front. Don't remember the last time I dyed eggs. And we also have their traditional Easter bread, which is here. It's called Pascha. And David's the real MVP because he found an authentic place that makes it, so thank you. And something that I've learned this past semester and things that I've been going through at school, and just also there's been an intersection here with things we've been talking about and learning here at church. So I learned that actually most of the Christians in Ukraine are Eastern Orthodox, which are kind of our half our other half in a sense. The early church, when it was growing and spreading like wildfire, the disciples had at one point over time were like, okay, so let's like write down all the things that we know that we believe in. And so when we're teaching people, we know that we're all kind of on the same page, right? And so then eventually over time, there were too many disagreements and they couldn't exactly all agree on what to write down and what they believed, right? So we can see this coming. So they ended up, okay, we're gonna split, we're gonna part ways. And so the Western Christian Church, which would be us, eventually grew and spread in Rome and what is today France and the UK and here in the States. And then also the Eastern Orthodox Church, our other half, spread in the Ukraine, what is now today Russia and Romania and the rest of Eastern Europe. So, and here's a picture that I pulled from online. They have vigils Thursday night, Friday night, Saturday night. It kind of depends on what church you're at. But this is a picture at one. And I loved the vibe with the candles, so that's why we have lots of candles this evening also. And like I said, the traditional bread is called Pascha, which is actually, I guess, their word for Easter. And it's typically made with nuts and dried fruit. I have no idea what this one is because David couldn't understand what the lady was saying. So she was speaking Ukraine. So we will open it later and find out what the flavor is. So our Orthodox brothers and sisters actually don't celebrate Holy Week or Good Friday, Easter, on the same day as us. They're actually going to be celebrating next week. And more to come on that about why our calendar is different. But this evening, I really just wanted to remember them and just say that we stand with them because I'm sure the season is much more difficult and more painful for them. The other reason we have candles tonight is to kind of get us in the place of our first piece of scripture, which is the arrest of Jesus. And as I read the scripture, I just invite you to kind of draw your eyes, if you don't want to close them completely, but place yourself in the scene. What would you be thinking, doing, feeling? Use all of your five senses. So I just encourage you, if you'd like to close your eyes, to use your imagination there. So Jesus and the disciples are in the Garden of Gethsemane, right before his arrest. And they have some privacy between the trees. The road isn't very far off, and there are some houses that are probably not far off. And Jesus has been praying, but it's late at night, and the disciples can't stay awake. Jesus went on a little further and fell to the ground. He prayed that if it were possible, the awful hour awaiting him might pass. Father, he cried out, everything with you is possible. Please take this cup of suffering from me. Yet I want your will to be done, not mine. And he returned, found the disciples sleeping, and he said to Peter, Simon, you're asleep. Couldn't you watch even 1 hour? Keep watch and pray so that you will not give in to temptation, for the spirit is willing, but the body is weak. Jesus left them again and prayed the same prayer as before. When he returned, he found them sleeping. And when they couldn't open their eyes, and he awoke them, and they didn't know what to say to him. And when he returned to them a third time, he said, go ahead and sleep. Have your rest. Oh, but know the time has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Up, let's be going. My betrayer is here. And immediately Judas, one of the 12 disciples, arrived with a crowd of men armed with swords and clubs, and they had been sent by the leading priests, the teachers of the law, the elders. The traitor Judas had given them a prearranged signal. You will know which one to arrest when I greet him with a kiss. Then you can take him away. As soon as they arrived, Judas walked up to Jesus. Rabbi, he exclaimed, and gave him a kiss. Then the others grabbed Jesus and arrested him. One of the men, Peter, with Jesus, pulled out a sword and struck a man, the high priest's slave, slashing off his ear. Jesus asked them, am I some dangerous revolutionary that you come with swords and clubs to arrest me? Why didn't you arrest me before when we were in the temple? I was there among you every day. But these things are happening to fulfill what the scriptures say about me. Then all his disciples deserted him. One young man following behind was clothed only in a long linen shirt. And when the mob tried to grab him, he slipped out of his shirt and ran away naked. And so that was the account of his arrest in the book of Mark. And so as you listen, where do you find yourself in this passage? There are two individuals I'd like to draw our attention to, and that's Peter and the young man there at the end. Would you have ran or would you have fought? We have been in a series here at Willow Grove Bible Church meditating and talking about praxis. And when we talk about praxis, it's really where the rubber meets the road in everyday life. When our faith takes over and really challenges us, and maybe sometimes we push out our faith. But in everyday life, in every aspect, our goal is to have our faith be driven and our decisions driven by our relationship with Christ. And we have crossroads all the time. Right, we have decisions, big, small, every day, 1,000 decisions to make. But the goal is for everyone to be made out of our decision with Christ, our relationship with Christ. And Jesus' death and arrest, there are a couple people that stand out to me just to their posture, their actions in that kind of situation. So first we have Peter, whom we've gotten to know over the past year. He reacts with gut instinct to the extreme. He says he will never waver in his loyalty to Jesus. Here he sees his friend, though, his mentor, roughly taken to the ground, wrestled to the ground and handcuffed. I kind of imagine it like one of those episodes in Cops where the cop suddenly throws somebody down and they have their face like smashed into the pavement. It was violent. And Peter reacts. He draws his sword and he's probably aiming to cut a guy's head off, but he just gets his ear. And, right, just the ear. And who imagined themselves reacting like Peter? Anybody would admit to that? I mean, after all, in one of the accounts, in one of the Gospels, Jesus says a few days before this, pack your bags and buy a sword on the way. And so Peter might have been thinking, oh, this is what he meant, right? This is what I'm supposed to do. But even afterwards, you know, Peter still denies that any of this happened. And then there's the guy at the end, who left behind his clothes. Then all the disciples deserted him and ran away. One young man following behind was clothed only in a long linen shirt. And when the mob tried to grab him, he slipped out of his shirt and ran away naked. So this guy stands out to me because he's the only time we hear about him is in the account of Mark. Why only this one? And he must have been running pretty darn fast to leave his clothes behind, right? And sometimes it seems to me when I read this, he might not have necessarily been with the disciples because they mention him in a completely different sentence. But what do we really know about him, right? Like they don't say his name. And so there's scholars think a couple of different things about who he was. Some think it was Mark who was writing about himself anonymously, confessing what he had done and where he was at. And some other people think that it might be John, the disciple that Jesus loved most, also running away. And some others think it might have been a guy who lived in a house not far from the garden, who came out to see what was happening. You know, something's happening down the road. Let's go see what it is. He's a bystander. He's a rubbernecker. He's one of those people that you see on the news who stand on the lawn in their pajamas watching a house fire or like watching an accident down the road, right? Like all these were like, how are you? What are you? Why are you outside dressed like this? I imagine him as one of those people. And if it had been Mark or John, remember they had just woken up in the garden, and he ran, leaving behind the little clothes that he had, which means he must have been scared, and scared enough to just leave it and not feel worried about being completely unprotected, that there's people with weapons behind him. But if he was a guy who lived nearby and who came out of his house, he must have been compelled enough, right, to hear, see, and listen. And maybe it was the time of year, you know, the political atmosphere at that time, it was very touchy, like, people didn't know what was going to happen. Somebody does something drastic, it could have been like wildfire, right? There could have been a revolt at any time. But Jesus was not there for a revolt. And once this guy realized it, and realized that he could be implicated in all of this, he could be taken off too, he was like, nope, I'm going to get out of here. I'll hightail it out of here. And so that would have been me. I would have been the one running. I don't know how fast, but I would have run as fast as I could. And I only would have been interested to stay just because of the privileges or the perks that I might have thought, ooh, like maybe this guy will like help me like get up in the social status or something. But I would have run. And anytime I'm asked to put skin in the game, or I'm in a conflict and I'm asked to put skin in the game, my immediate reaction is like, ooh, like do I have to go there? So I would have run, and I would have waited till things calmed down, hidden behind somebody's house. And so this piece of scripture stands out to me, comes to me over the semester because of how somehow in our disloyalty and in the violence of that situation and while people are running, Jesus, in his authority, still says what he says in John 10:18, which I think is just so powerful. No one can take my life from me. I sacrifice it for you voluntarily. For I have the authority to lay it down when I want to, and also to take it up again. See, when we react like Peter or the young man running away, we are reacting to a fear that there is something more powerful than Jesus' death and resurrection. But in fact, that's not true. That's not reality. What Jesus was saying when he allowed people to arrest him, he was saying, you know, this isn't about the fire. It's not about the swords. This is about me and what I'm doing, regardless of what you think this arrest looks like. It might look like the enemy is winning, but it's not. And Jesus had for them a new and larger vision. He was like trying to be like, look, see, like, I'm trying to be more for you. I'm trying to show my power more to you. But that power was upside down. It was backwards, right? It doesn't look like the power that we imagine power to be in everyday life now. So they missed it. Missed opportunity. And this is the first time the disciples fully realized that he wasn't coming with a rebellion. And ultimately, Peter's reaction and fear tells us that he thought it was easier to fight for Jesus than to die for him. And in a different gospel account, Jesus says to Peter, when he cuts the guy's ear off, he's like, that's enough. We don't need that. And he just, boop, like, heals the guy's ear, just puts it right back on. Like, can you imagine being that guy? Like you're there to capture somebody with the aim to eventually kill him, or like, and then he heals your ear? And you've asked nothing? You've never met the guy before? So at that crossroad, in that conflict, there was an opportunity to see an expanded picture of Jesus. In the arrest, the young man in his robe and Peter had an image, but it wasn't quite big enough. And God was asking them, you know, let me show you a bigger picture. He wanted to show more of his character, give more blessings. And he wanted to take on more of that fear that they had in their lives. He wanted to take that from them because it was a burden. And so that's part of what we miss out on when we react too quickly in like fight or flight mode. And there's a third person who strikes me in another section of scripture that I'm going to read. And so we're going to fast forward to Mark 15:16. The soldiers took Jesus into the courtyard of the governor's headquarters and called out the entire regiment, all the gods. They dressed him in a purple robe. They wove thorn branches into a crown and put it on his head. And then they saluted him and taunted him, "Hail, King of the Jews." And they stuck the crown on his head, struck him with a reed stick, spit on him, and dropped to their knees in mock worship. And when they were finally tired of that, they took off the purple robe, put his clothes back on, and led him away. There was a passerby named Simon of Cyrene, who was coming down from the countryside just then, and the soldiers forced him to carry the cross for Jesus. Simon was the father of Alexander and Rufus, and they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, place of the skull. When the soldiers nailed him to the cross, they then divided his clothes and threw dice to decide who would get each piece. And a sign and above his head announced the charge against him. It read, "King of the Jews." So then we have Simon, right? And again, we don't know a whole lot about Simon, other than he was from Cyrene, which is an area in Greece, I believe. And he was simply passing by as this procession of people are taking Jesus up the hill. And he was the father of the two men mentioned. And so some people think that he just volunteered to carry the cross out of sympathy. He was compelled, he was convicted. But scripture doesn't necessarily say that. Scripture says that the soldiers just forced him to carry the cross for Jesus. And I wonder what his attitude was like in that moment. He was like, "Oh shoot, like, I'm all of a sudden in the middle of this." Like, was he happy about it? Was he honored? Was he annoyed? Like, how much was he understanding what he was even in the middle of? We don't know, but we do know his action. So he carried the cross the whole way, down the road and up the hill. And he was trudging with a man who looked and smelled like death. And he was headed in the same direction as Jesus. So I have a couple examples of opportunities, things that come to my mind as I think about the classes I've sat in and the conversations we've had here at church over the past few months about responding to the crossroads, responding to conflict, and those opportunities being where Jesus wants to show us a bigger picture of himself that we just don't fully see at the time. So this semester, I took a church history class, which didn't exactly excite me. David's more of a history person than I am. And the first day of class, my professor said, "You must learn church history in order to love the church. You cannot love what you do not know." And this struck me as such a profound thing when I think about our brothers and sisters who are persecuted in other places in the world, and how little we know about them, but we share this history with them. 2,000 years of history, right? And like I mentioned earlier, Western Christianity and the Orthodox Church split about a little over 1,000 years after Jesus walked the earth. And 1,000 years, like a long time, right? So over time, there were disagreements, right? Like a little bit. Disagreements all along the way between members, between church leaders, but none of those disagreements ever got fully resolved, fully healed. So there's these layers and layers of hurt. But do you know what the tipping point was? What the tipping point that set them over the edge to be like, "Nope, I'm not going to talk to you anymore. We're going to excommunicate each other." That tipping point was when the church no longer prayed for each other, for the people in the church that they disagreed with. And they had a tradition then of always praying in every service for the whole church, its entirety. And at some point, somebody decided they just weren't going to pray for the other side anymore. And somebody on the other side heard about it. So in one word, they ran away from each other, right? And then later on, they even fought each other. Like, during the age of the Crusades-ish, like, after the split, the Western Church sacked and plundered and destroyed the city that was the center of the Orthodox Church. Just for the money and the hurt. So I can't help but wonder what would have happened if they hadn't stopped praying for one another. And what if instead they took a stance of reconciliation? And reconciling is when I, as a believer, accepting Christ as my Savior, recognize that He makes me whole, but I still can't be a whole person if I am in contention with another believer, because that other believer and I are part of Christ's body. So you can't have that contention because it's contrary to Christ's love. Christ, who makes me whole, therefore compels us to restore those relationships that have been torn, because I cannot love what I do not know. And if I have that contention, I don't know that person. So here, we have an opportunity in front of us to trudge. I love that word, trudge, in the same direction as Jesus. And I love that word because there's a heaviness to it, but there's like a determination to it at the same time. Like, you feel tired, your feet feel heavy, but you're going. And we had a couple weeks ago, we had a jam-packed church family meeting where we just kind of did a recap over the past year. People shared what was happening in their activities and in their ministries. We heard highlights, and we also heard about Pastor Jason's sabbatical, and there was a long list of ideas thrown around about what people loved about what we were doing, and also things that we wish we could do differently and things we could improve on. And I haven't gotten a chance to talk with everybody, but there were a lot of emotions for me, I know for sure. Part of me felt like excited, part of me felt like overwhelmed by all of these ideas. Making a decision about which and how we will act on those ideas, what we do next, it will involve a give and take. Everybody has their own perspective, their own gifts. It'll involve granting one another grace. It'll involve patience and an absolute reliance on Jesus. And we cannot move or improve what we're doing if we think that fighting for Jesus is easier than dying for Him, or that fighting one another is easier than dying for one another by setting aside our own personal priorities. We might feel like we want to run away, but I just encourage you to always remember that Jesus' authority is over this church. This is His church. It's not our church. And I feel like we can rest in that. Jesus' authority is over our fears. It's over our money. It's over our assets. His authority is over this building. And it can, it's also over what can at times feel like a lack of people power, a lack of time. And then lastly, we have an individual choice, each of us. Have you been running from Jesus? Because either you don't think He'll make a difference, or, oh, I've been doing just fine without church since the pandemic, or since before then. And it feels like the conflict only grows each day recently, whether it's conflict internally, within our families, globally. But within that uncomfortable, painful, gnawing, wrestling, deconstructing, He knew that you would fight, and He knew that you would run away. He knew it the whole time. And still He said, "No one can take my life from me. I sacrifice it for you voluntarily, for I have the authority to lay it down when I want to, and also to take it up again." And so I'll invite the worship team to come back up. We'll, you know, already have up. But so where do we place ourselves in this story? Are we Peter? Are we the young naked man? Are we Simon trudging along? Can you see yourself in this picture? We'll leave the picture up so you can come up and look at it afterwards. But I just find it so profound, like the faces. It's the 12 disciples. This painting is titled Holy Saturday. The disciples are together in that weird in-between time between Jesus is taken off the cross and the resurrection. So can you imagine that in-between time? Like, they had no idea what was going on. No clue. Would they be pursued? Would they be killed? What do they even do next? And the shame and the guilt when they realized that they just ran. And this man sacrificed himself. I can find myself in that picture. My church history professor was born in Romania. If you don't know where Romania is, it's in Eastern Europe. And it shares a bit of its border with Ukraine. And it shares a communist history also with that area of the world. One of his parents was Orthodox, and the other was Western Christian. And his family would attend two Good Friday services, two Easter services. And then one was typical, like ours, and the other one was in a graveyard. The Orthodox service was held in a graveyard, and that's not like a traditional thing, that was just like his town. And it was also the same graveyard where people in that town would dump their dead horses. So that's where we are this evening. Future note, I would love to have a Good Friday service in a graveyard. Figured that wouldn't happen that fast this evening. But that's where we are. We're at the place of the skull, watching Jesus die. And somehow the disciples went on, life went on for them the 3 days after. So picture it, the pile of horse bones, maybe there's a fresh one there, the smell, it's disgusting. But it's the dichotomy of life and death. And next to the dead is still where his church would celebrate. Jesus saying, "No one takes my life from me. I sacrifice it for you voluntarily. For I have the authority to lay it down when I want to, and also to take it up again." Mm-hmm. So we're going to sing two closing songs. And then I'll come back up and do a brief closing prayer. And we just want to make sure people know that if you would like to stay afterwards to pray, to linger, please feel free to do so. And also, if you would like prayer with somebody, we're more than welcome to do that with you, Larry, Michael, myself. And just let us know. So thank you.
The Lord.
some words that we can use when sometimes we don't know how to pray, when we don't know what to say, when things that are so difficult to understand like this. I'm going to use a poem called Good Friday for our prayer. Am I a stone and not a sheep that I can stand, O Christ, beneath thy cross? To number drop by drop thy blood's slow loss and yet not weep? Not so those women who loved, who with exceeding grief lamented you. Not so for Peter weeping bitterly. Not so the thief that was moved. Not so the sun and moon which hid their faces in a starless sky. A horror of great darkness at broad noon. I, only I. Yet give not over, but seek thy sheep, true shepherd of the flock. Greater than Moses, turn and look once more, and smite a rock. God, we confess that we can be rocks. We can be hard and bitter against people and against you, Father, but I just ask your forgiveness for that. I ask that you would break through that rock texture in us and teach us more about yourself. And may we be aware to the times that you're giving us an opportunity to see more of you in front of us. Thank you for your sacrifice. Help us understand more of that every day.